And so remember, Stephen's one of the seven commissioned to help with the care of the widows who were to help to free up the apostles so they could devote themselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And so through this ministry, Stephen is growing in his faith and his leadership skills and developing as a minister of the word. And so from Acts 6 and 7, we know that Stephen was this faithful witness for Christ, and he was gifted by the Holy Spirit, and he used his gifts, and he used them well for God's kingdom. He was a great administrator, a great debater of the faith, speaker. He was a messenger of the gospel. And so on chapter 7 is really a turning point in the entire narrative of Acts. I hope you've been reading through Acts, and maybe even take a chapter a day as your personal devotion time, and you'll get through Acts in about 28 days. So next month, if you start in February 1st, you'll get through Acts, and then you'll have a day of rest on Leap Day. So that's one way to look at it. Stephen's speech in Acts 7 focuses on the way that Israel continued to resist the patriarchs and Moses and the other Old Testament prophets, which climax in the betrayal of Jesus and his that they betrayed Jesus and he was killed and on a cross. And so the purpose of Stephen's speech is not to make his own defense. He's not trying to win acquittal from what is going on. And in fact, he's using this time to make a reasoned argument by which he can do two things, which he can help others to be set free in Jesus and allow the gospel to go forward, as well as point out those who were out to get him and the gospel. So he's defending the faith, not trying to defend his way out of an acquittal. So rather, the purpose of his speech is to make this careful, argued case that the people of Israel have consistently rejected God and those God sent as his messengers. And so ultimately, Stephen wants to give glory to Jesus and at the same time convict the Jewish leaders who have denied Jesus' name. And so last week, we looked at the first two parts of Stephen's speech, and we learned how the promises given to Abraham were foundational for the people of Israel, and how Joseph was blessed with grace and with wisdom for the salvation of God's people. Now, today we're going to be continuing our study through the book of Acts, where we're going to focus on the third part of Stephen's speech, with focuses on how Moses was blessed for the salvation of the people of God. Remember, if you look, go through and you read the story of Moses, how he delivered the people of Israel from slavery in Egypt into the promised land. And so we're going to be looking at kind of a long section here. If you like history, if you like the biblical narrative, this is the sermon for you. We're going to be walking through a lot of Moses's life. So if you have a Bible with you, we're going to be looking at Acts 7, starting in verse 17. We'll be reading through Acts 38. I pray that I can get through all that without making any kind of crazy errors, but you never know what God has in store. The pew Bible in front of you, if you forgot your Bible or you want to have a book with you for the Bible, it's on page 972, okay? So let me see if we can walk through this. Just a really amazing passage, and if Moses is one of your favorite characters in the Bible, you're going to learn a little bit more about him today. So in verse 17, Stephen has this amazing section here where he begins saying, "As the time was approaching to fulfill the promise that God had made to Abraham, the people flourished and multiplied in Egypt, until a different king who did not know Joseph ruled over Egypt. He dealt deceitfully with our race and oppressed our ancestors by making them abandon their infants outside so that they wouldn't survive. At this time, Moses was born, and he was beautiful in God's sight. He was cared for in his father's home for 3 months. When he was put outside, Pharaoh's daughter adopted and raised him as her own son. So Moses was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was powerful in his speech and actions. When he was 40 years old, he decided to visit his own people, the Israelites. When he saw one of them being mistreated, he came to rescue and avenge the oppressed man by striking down the Egyptian. He assumed his people would understand that God would give them deliverance through him, but they did not understand. The next day, he showed up while they were fighting and tried to reconcile them peacefully, saying, 'Men, you are brothers. Why are you mistreating each other? But the one who was mistreating his neighbor pushed Moses aside, saying, "Who appointed you a ruler and a judge over us? Do you want to kill me the same way you killed the Egyptian yesterday?" When he heard this, Moses fled and became an exile in the land of Midian, where he became the father of two sons. After 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai in the flame of a burning bush. When Moses saw it, he was amazed at the sight. As he was approaching to look at it, the voice of the Lord came, "I am the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob." Moses began to tremble and did not dare look. The Lord said to him, "Take off the sandals from your feet, because the place where you are standing is holy ground. I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their groanings and have come down to set them free. And now come, I will send you to Egypt. This Moses whom you rejected when they said, 'Who appointed you a ruler and a judge?' This one God sent as a ruler and a deliverer through the angel who appeared to him in a bush. This man led them out and performed wonders and signs in the land of Egypt, at the Red Sea, and in the wilderness for 40 years. This is the Moses who said to the Israelites, 'God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your brothers and sisters.' He is the one who was the assembly in the wilderness with the angel who spoke to him on Mount Sinai and with our ancestors. He received living oracles to give to us." Let us pray. Father, we are so thankful and so just blown away by this amazing passage. That's a wonderful servant of yours, Moses, and the story of that, and how Stephen brings that in to the text here. And so I pray, God, that you will help us understand this passage in a deeper way. And we thank you, God, because you are the God of all life, and you help us to appreciate the great gift that is human life, formed in your image, a reflection of your love and holiness. And we pray for all whom you have created. Bring them peace and into the fold of your loving arms, children not yet born, families affected by poverty, illness, tragedy, and war, people of different abilities, people from other lands, and all who are victims of persecution, hatred, and injustice. Help us to bear witness to the dignity and sanctity of life of all whom you have created, regardless of stage of life or wealth or ability or color, for every person has value in your loving eyes and is created in your image. And so, Father, we thank you, God, for this amazing passage. I pray, God, for the words that come out of my mouth this morning to be pleasing to you. I pray, God, that your Spirit will be upon us now to help us to understand this passage in a much deeper way. And most of all, help us to go out and to live this life that you've called us to live. In your name we pray. Amen. And so one of the things that's really amazing about this passage is that Stephen presents this life and career of Moses. And I've put some things on your handout to kind of walk you through the structure of the speech here that we've looked at. So I want to look at the thing is kind of broken down into three sections and focusing on three different 40-year phases of Moses' life. And so if you're into history, this is the amazing passage here about that. So Acts 17 through 22 focuses on the first 40 years of his life, his birth, his time in Pharaoh's court, and also gives this theological and historical context for his ministry. Where did he come out? He just didn't come out into existence and all of a sudden become the one who delivered the Israelites, you know, from Egypt and the Promised Land. He had a backstory. He had a life. He had a wonderful childhood and was given all kinds of power and prestige and privilege under the hands of Pharaoh. And so the second part of the sermon here, section that we looked at, it focuses on the second 40 years of his life, which Stephen describes in Acts 7, 23 through 29. And it illustrates how and why Moses fled Egypt at 40 years old and stayed in Midian, kind of the time between his time in Egypt and then the time where he is called by God to go and to help the Israelites be delivered. And the last part here is from Acts 7, 30 through 43, which covers the last 40-year phase, and we'll look at kind of a part of that this morning, of Moses' life, which reveals how he was commissioned by God to deliver the Hebrews. And so Moses was 80 years old when the Lord appeared to him in a burning bush. Stephen then focuses here on the Lord coming to Moses in the burning bush and Exodus and Sinai and the wandering wilderness, which we'll look at next week. So let's look a little bit closer at this third part of Stephen's speech, which focuses on Moses' life and his ministry. And so looking at verse 17, he says that the time was approaching to fulfill the promise that God had made to Abraham. The people flourished and multiplied in Egypt. So these verses 17 through 19, which we read earlier, focus and cover the events of the first chapter of the book of Exodus. If you want to know more about Moses' life, go and read the book of Exodus, especially the first 15 chapters, which deals with kind of the story of how he went from having a lot of power and prestige under Egyptian Pharaoh to then being part of the people and being the leader of how they got from Egypt all the way to the Promised Land. And then if you continue in the book of Acts, you'll know how God gave the law to Moses and how they set up the tabernacle and everything else. So Exodus is a fantastic book of the Bible. And so Stephen reveals that there was this specific time that was appointed by God for the fulfillment of the promise of Abraham. And so the people who were descendants of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob have become and have grown rapidly and have multiplied. However, with the multiplication that was going on with the descendants, they also became this predictive captivity of the people of Abraham. And so Pharaoh, who was the king of Egypt, begins to fear that the Israelites may begin to outnumber the Egyptians. He's afraid of people rising up and to have a rebellion against the Egyptians. And so he calls for the extermination of the firstborn sons of the Israelites. But in verse 20, Luke says the following. At this time, Moses was born. He was beautiful in God's sight. He was cared for in his father's home for 3 months. When he was put outside, Pharaoh's daughter adopted and raised him as his own. So Moses was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians. It was powerful in his speech and his actions. And so these verses in Acts are summarizing the events that happen in the first 10 verses of Exodus 2. And so at this critical time, Moses was born. And so Stephen wants his listeners to know that Moses came at the appointed correct time that God had set apart. So there is this parallel between, if you look at the life of Moses and the life of Christ, there's a lot of parallels between them. And so they were both born at the appointed time in God's big overarching plan to redeem his people. As Paul says in Galatians 4:4-5, when the time came to completion, God sent his son born of a woman born under the law to redeem those under the law so that we might receive the adoption as sons. And so God's sovereign will was orchestrating all these events. Now, the story talks about how a Levite woman had a baby boy, and in order to save the child from the hands of Pharaoh, she hid him for a time and then put him in a papyrus basket, sent him by the bank of the Nile. And so Pharaoh's daughter found the basket with the child in it, and they adopted him as her child. And so she named him Moses because she drew him out of the water. That's kind of where the name comes from. So Moses was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and he was powerful, says the text, in his speech and his actions. And so as the child of Pharaoh's daughter, Moses was given every privilege, including education. And so Moses grew to be very wise. And so Stephen has this section here where he uses this phrase, powerful, that Moses was powerful in his speech and actions, the last part phrase of verse 22, and reveals that he was a prophet. The end of Deuteronomy 10-12 reveals no prophet has arisen again like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. He was unparalleled for all the signs and wonders the Lord sent him to do against the land of Egypt, to Pharaoh, to all his officials, and to all his land, and for all the mighty acts of power and terrifying deeds that Moses performed in the sight of all Israel. And so as we know, Moses went on to become the deliverer of the chosen people of God from slavery in Egypt. And so if you look at this phrase, powerful in action, and you look at through it through the rest of the Bible, in Luke's gospel, when Jesus appears to men on the road to Emmaus in Luke 24:19, the men answer Jesus' question with the following, the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth. For he was a prophet, powerful in action and speech before God and all the people. And so Stephen is addressing the Jewish leaders, and he's addressing them. He wants them to know that Moses is a foreshadow of the Messiah because he delivered the people from bondage. And verse 23 says, when he was 40 years old, he decided to visit his own people, the Israelites. When he saw one of them being mistreated, he came to rescue and avenge the oppressed man by striking down the Egyptian. He assumed his people would understand that God would give them deliverance through him, but they did not understand. And so Stephen is marking this moment when Moses decided to visit his own people. We're not sure about, Stephen doesn't talk about how Moses found out about who he truly was, but here we have this passage here in Acts 7, 23 through 25, and it's a parallel to the story in Exodus and Exodus 2, verses 1 through 12. New Testament scholar Charles Barrett writes, Moses intends to come out of his royal environment in Egypt, not only to see, but to assist his fellow Israelites. So he wasn't down there to check out and see what's going on with the Hebrews. He had come to figure out a way to help them. And so to do this was risky. It was extremely risky, but an important move that Moses wanted to make. So he was distancing himself by going down and visiting the Hebrews. He was distancing himself from the comforts and the protection and the power and the privilege that he had under Pharaoh. If you look through this amazing chapter in Hebrews 11 that talks about people of the faith, verses 23 through 29, we have time to look at that this morning, but I did put it on your handout so you can read it for later. It describes the faith and action of Moses. And so Moses had this deeper sense of divine purpose and calling, and he felt his life had a great purpose even before God called him at the burning bush. Verse 26, the next day he showed up while they were fighting and tried to reconcile them peacefully, saying, men, you are brothers, why are you mistreating each other? But the one who was mistreating his brother pushed Moses aside and said, who appointed you a ruler and judge over us? Do you want to kill me the same way you killed the Egyptian yesterday? When he heard this, Moses fled and became an exile in the land of Midian, where he became the father of two sons. So these verses in Acts, they tell the story of Exodus 2, verses 13 and 14. And so Moses was a mediator between the two Israelites who were fighting. And so he tries to reconcile them and to be a peacemaker. And he asks them, why are you mistreating each other? But his concern for the Israelites, his very own people, was not appreciated. The Israelite pushes Moses and says, who appointed you a ruler or a judge over us? Do you want to kill me the same way you killed the Egyptian yesterday? And so Moses is kind of blown away by what happens, and he flees. He goes into exile. He's ashamed of the fact that he murdered someone, which Stephen doesn't talk about in specific terms. But if you go back and you read the story in Exodus, it's pretty clear about what Moses did. In verse 30, after 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai in the flame of a burning bush. When Moses saw it, he was amazed at the sight. As he was approaching to look at it, the voice of the Lord came, I am the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and Jacob. And so Moses began to tremble and did not dare look. And so you have 40 years pass. So Moses is 80 at this point, and he has this encounter with God at the burning bush. And so Stephen summarizes the narrative of Exodus 3 over the next few verses in Acts. So there's no question that God was acting in advance of his purposes for his people in the amazing way. After 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai in the flame of a burning bush. And so the angel appears to Moses in the flames of a burning bush. Now, Stephen uses the word here, angel, and it's important, for the angel he is referring to is not just any angel. You have to go back and read the story in Exodus about who the angel actually was. And Exodus 3:2 reveals it's the angel of the Lord. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire within a bush. As Moses looked, he saw that the bush was on fire, but was not consumed. The phrase angel of the Lord is used 67 times in the Old Testament. The Hebrew term Malakha Yahweh is grammatically oppositional. It best translated as the angel that is Yahweh, or angel Yahweh, or angel Yahweh, however you want to put that. But the text is not saying that Yahweh, the Lord God himself, is an angel. That's what he's not saying. Rather, the angel of the Lord is coming in a burning bush is a manifestation or a representation of the Lord God himself. So God is not sending a messenger in the bush. He comes himself, and he chooses to present himself in this way. As one scholar pointed out, what Moses saw was an angel in the flames of a burning bush, but what he heard was the voice of the very Lord God, identifying himself as the God of the patriarchs, and by implication, the God of the covenant. This phrase, the angel of the Lord, again is used over 60 times in the Old Testament. Most of the time it's referring to God himself. And so that's something that you really want to point out here, and it's very important. So look at verses 33 and 34. The Lord said to him, "Take off the sandals from your feet, because the place where you are standing is holy ground. I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their groaning and have come down to set them free. And now come, I will send you to Egypt." And so the place where God is making his presence known is holy. When God enters the room, when God enters his temple, wherever God is, he is holy. So earlier in Acts, Luke is describing how the apostles and the other followers of Jesus met in the temple area. Now, we talked about this several weeks ago, but the temple was the place where God was part of. He was there. His presence was in the temple. Maybe if you go back and you read some of the Old Testament, where in 1 Kings, where they were presenting the temple, and Solomon was preparing the temple and building it, and finally was ready for the temple to start its function, and the presence of God enters the temple. So the temple in the Old Testament was a holy place. But it's not the only place or the ultimate place where God is met. God was able and about to liberate his people from bondage in accordance with the promise he made to Abraham. And from this holy place where he is with Moses, Moses is commissioned to be God's agent of deliverance of the Israelites from Egypt. Stephen continues on and says, "This Moses in verse 35, whom you rejected, when they said, 'Who appointed you a judge?' This one God sent as a ruler and deliverer through the angel who appointed him in the bush. This man led them out, performed wonders and signs in the land of Egypt, at the Red Sea, in the wilderness for 40 years. What is Stephen doing here? He's basically putting evidence upon evidence of all the things that they should have known, these Jewish leaders, and they didn't realize what was going on. And so these verses mark a change in the speech for dramatic effect. Stephen switches from articulating this narrative story of Israel to bringing these series of declarative statements about him. So God is commissioning Moses to be the Israelites' ruler and deliverer and accomplish his plan of redemption and deliverance for his people through the leadership of Moses. God chooses Moses to be the vehicle by which how he freed the people who were in bondage. So Stephen is drawing a link between Moses on the one hand and Christ on the other. The same Greek roots for redemption are used in the story of Moses as well as numerous places in the New Testament. For example, in a passage that we ended the sermon with last week, Paul says the following in Colossians 1, verses 13 and 14, "For the Lord has rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the Son he loves. In him we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Rescue, it's a word of exodus, deliverance. Look at verses, Acts 7, verse 37. This is the Moses who said to the Israelites, so Stephen is addressing the Jewish leaders at this point. This is the Moses who said to the Israelites, God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your brothers and sister. So Stephen continues this link between Moses and Christ. He's basically saying to the Jewish leaders, if you know who Moses really is and what his function really is, then you should understand why Jesus came and what Jesus did. There's a connection between the two. He's saying, God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among the brothers, which is a direct quotation of Deuteronomy 18. Jesus is the promised one like Moses who brings ultimate redemption for his people. Stephen wants the Jewish leaders to know that as heirs of the prophets, they should know that the prophet Moses was describing was none other than Jesus of Nazareth, who they killed and put to death. They should see this link between Moses on the one hand and Jesus on the other, and they have blinded their eyes towards this truth. Verse 38 says, he is the one who was in the assembly in the wilderness with the angel who spoke to him on Mount Sinai, and with our ancestors, he received the living oracles to give to us the law. So Stephen further develops this link between Moses and Christ. He uses the word church here, or assembly. It's used several other times in the Old Testament for the day of assembly, or for when the people have come, or the assembly of the Lord, or the assembly of the people of God coming together to worship. Those whom God redeemed from Egypt gathered together to hear his words at Sinai were constituted as a holy nation whose role was to express their distinctive relationship with the Lord by continuing to obey his word. And so the people of God were given and gathered by God to himself as the Lord's assembly. Stephen is saying, you were there with Moses gathering around the tabernacle, and later under David and Solomon under the temple. And so you had this gathering, this assembly, and now he's saying the church is part of that gathering. So Jesus is a Moses-like figure who forms and sustains the new people of God around himself. But see, his assembly is not fixed around an earthly mountain, or like Sinai, like a building, or like the temple. See, the Sinai, the assembly that Jesus was gathering was an assembly that was centered around all those who have trusted in him and have received and are equipped by the Holy Spirit to minister, to serve, and love people. So what Stephen is getting at in the central section of this speech is that true Israel, who the Jewish leaders are angry at, are the ones who have pledged their allegiance to Jesus and have come to him for salvation, redemption, and restoration. True Israel, all those, Jews and Gentiles, are the ones who have received the gift of new life and the Spirit. And so their identity, their character, their purpose is found in no one else but Jesus, his Spirit, and the proclamation of the good news for the world. It's amazing how you see the history between how Moses led the people out of Egypt into the promised land and how Jesus is bringing people together through his ministry as well, and seeing the link between those two as people who have delivered others from sin and darkness and bondage. And so last week we learned Stephen's speech on Abraham and Joseph. And he did this to trace God's actions through the history of the Jewish people. And so this week we continue to look through how Stephen was preaching about Moses, and he was using this for the same reason. And so in both instances, it was to show how what he and the disciples were preaching, Stephen and the disciples were preaching, was not something that was contrary to what Abraham and Moses taught their own people. It was just the continuing story of the big story of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. It's one big narrative story. past, present, and future. So the Jewish people had a hard time believing there could be a prophet greater than Moses. Even Moses himself said there would be. Stephen is pointing out that the time had come for that prophet who they talked about, it was prophesied in Deuteronomy, and the people had rejected him. So these people were unable, these Jewish leaders were unable to see Jesus for who Jesus really was. And they rejected him and his disciples. And the crazy thing is they had all this history of Israel to know who the Messiah was going to be, what he was going to do, and who he came to fix. This is amazing because they should have known their own history and the words of the prophets and paid attention. So Stephen's history lesson, and this is important for all of us here, is just as important for us and for me today as it was for the Jewish people in the first century. See, we read these passages in the Bible and we're amazed at how people who saw the actual physical miracles or the occupied space and time with Jesus could be so obtuse. How can you possibly see what Jesus is doing and know who he is and still have your eyes darkened and your heart hardened to what was going on? And so we all have to think about that in our own life. Are we seeing Jesus for who he really is? Have our eyes been blinded to what he's doing? Are our hearts hardened like the Israelites or like Ezekiel? Do we have a heart of flesh whose spirit is moving through? See, how could these people not know this? But see, we're in an even better position. See, you and I have the Old and New Testament, which records all of this history, and so often we neglect to read it. Right? We have a book that's kind of sitting on our bookshelf, and we haven't opened it in years, and it's dusty. We've got all the answers to life sitting right next to us, and yet we're not opening it up. We don't want to know the story. We think that there's something else out there that's going to have the answers to all our problems. And so we neglect to spend the time and effort to understand it. You know, this is the book of life. God has given it to us to know who he is. And so if we want to know who he is, we have to read about the book that talks about who he is. Am I right? So we neglect to be diligent in seeking the whole counsel of God, which was provided for us in his entire biblical narrative. So we are not so different from the first century Jews or those who rebelled against Moses. We too need to be reminded that Jesus fulfills all of Scripture. Not just a couple texts in the Old Testament passages or prophecies, not just a few of the Psalms. Jesus fulfills all of it. As Paul says in 2 Corinthians 1:20, in him it is always yes. For every one of God's promises is yes in him. Everything has been fulfilled in Jesus. And to know that, we need to know all of Scripture. Not just our favorite verses, not just the ones we like, not just the ones that, you know, we make us feel better, but all of it. So not only do we need to read all of Scripture to understand who Jesus is, even books like the boring Leviticus, but if you know the big story, Leviticus is magical. It talks about stuff that we don't even think about if we actually go and look at it. The whole idea of loving your neighbor comes from Leviticus. Or those wonderful, crazy genealogies that we read at the beginning of Matthew's gospel, or the first, I think, what is it, 10 or 9 chapters in 1 Chronicles that just talks about who's who. Passage that we can get lost in. But we need to know all of it. We need to read all of Scripture if we want to be the kind of witness Stephen was. He knew the story. So he could tell the Jewish leaders what they missed in the story. And these are people who basically spend their entire lives reading God's word and interpreting it, and they still missed it. So one of the main reasons people are hesitant to share their faith is because they're afraid they will not be able to answer the questions or the objections others may have. But Peter, in his first letter, 1 Peter verses 3 through 15, is adamant that we need to be ready at any time to give a defense to anyone who asks us for a reason for the hope that is in us. If you're sitting on the subway on the way to work and you're sitting there reading your Bible and someone comes over and says, tell me about this thing. You can't tell them, well, I got to go back and study for about 2 weeks and then we can meet for dinner. You may never see this person again. You got to be ready. The best way to prepare to answer questions is to know who Jesus really is. To take time, make the effort to read the Bible thoroughly, not just a passage here and there in the morning as part of your 15-minute devotional, but rather read the Bible narrative from Genesis to Revelation. And if reading through the Bible in a year is too much, then there's nothing wrong with reading the Bible in 3 years, 2 years, 5 years. Just read it. Start in page one and read to the end of it. However long it takes you, your life will be transformed. We have to read the Bible from start to finish. Learn and understand what the biblical narrative is all about, the one that Stephen was pointing out in this sermon. He doesn't start with, the Jewish leaders say to him, how can you preach this stuff in the temple? It's lies and propaganda. And so Stephen doesn't start with, well, see, Jesus died on the cross and was saved from our sins, and so now I'm going to trust in him. Stephen begins at page one. He gives you the big story. He gives you all the things the Jewish leaders missed out on, even though they were the so-called experts of the Bible. See, God doesn't want us to be a so-called expert of the Bible just so that we can fill our heads with knowledge. He wants our hearts to be transformed by his word so that we can be more conformed to his image, so that we can show the world what it really means to be a human being tied to Jesus. So I highly recommend to read and understand the Bible, understand the themes and the principles. So I really hope that you, if you don't have a study Bible, go purchase one. If you're not sure which one to purchase, let me give you a few that I think are highly recommended that I've even used in the past. The NIV Study Bible, the NIV Life Application Study Bible, which is the first Bible I was ever given after I became a Christian. And I've been using it for however long I've been a Christian, since 1997. CSB, if you want to use the same translation I'm using my sermons, there's a CSB Study Bible or the ES Study Bible, which I think overall, even though, you know, if you don't like that translation, the notes in the Study Bible for the ESV is fantastic. One of those four, find another one that you like, but all these have been recently updated and can really help the Word of God come alive to you and visually. There's a team of 50, 100 scholars that bring these words together who have spent a lot more time studying the little nuances of the text and can allow the words to just come alive to you and to help you walk through this stuff that's in the Bible, this wonderful narrative. So we need to know how God has worked through history. And otherwise, we're going to have no idea how he's working through it now. He doesn't change. He works the same way he worked in the beginning. We need to know how God has worked in history. We need to know how the Old Testament feasts and sacrifices were fulfilled in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. That Scripture is one big story that includes history, law, poetry, prophecy, and exhortation. And it all fits together. This story that spans 2,000 years in our Bible and all kinds of different genres to read. If you like poetry, the Bible has some of the most beautiful poetry ever written. It all fits together. So when you know it well, like Stephen did, you can know who God is, what he's like, how he works in and through his people. So we often pray for the Holy Spirit to give us the right words to say when we are not sure what to say in certain situations. But these words are not manifested from thin air. They come to us from somewhere. We need to ask the Holy Spirit to remind us of the words we have read in our Bibles, what we have learned in church history, what we have learned in the body of Christ. So I want you to take away from what we've talked about this morning is twofold. The first is that Jesus was part of a long history of God interacting with humanity to bring about salvation. What Stephen and the disciples were preaching, what Jesus preached, was in line with everything that God had already done and already promised for his people. Jesus is the climax of the story, not the beginning of it. The second is this, that Stephen was a powerful witness, not because he was some sort of super spiritual person, but because he was prepared. He knew the scriptures. He had been diligently seeking discipleship and to know who Jesus was, and he wanted to know and understand who his true identity was in Christ. And so I challenge you to see Stephen as an example of what diligent discipleship produces. His discipleship did not take place overnight, and neither will yours. You cannot microwave a disciple. Right? It takes a lifetime. There's no shortcut. There's no special formula. There's no secret regimen that you can take. Our mission statement is to become and make disciples who love and serve Jesus. In order to make a disciple, you've got to be willing to be one. So if you are serious about that and thought about explaining who Jesus is and what he did in that manner, like Stephen, if that scares you because you feel unprepared or you want to change your heart, let's have a conversation. So we can walk together as disciples to build each other up into the people who can speak to those in our families and communities about Jesus so that they can know the transforming power of salvation. That's why we're here. That's our purpose. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your wonderful witnesses like Stephen who have just come up through the ranks from understanding and trusting in you of salvation and receiving the Spirit and being given little things to do in ministry, and now you're standing before God, before the Jewish leaders, and you're sharing the story. That's who Stephen was. And so Stephen was willing to do whatever he was called to do by God, knowing the whole biblical story, and even to the point of death. And so maybe God will not call us to be a martyr for our faith, but we are supposed to be growing in our walks with you and to understand who you are and have a deeper relationship with you if we truly love you. And so I pray, God, this morning, I pray that you will soften our hearts towards your word to help us reinvigorate our faith for your word and to sharing your word with others. And so I thank you, God, for your many blessings this morning and for the time that we can be with you to worship you and to learn. In your name we pray. Amen. So